So this was a lot harder to figure out than it probably should have been. But there's a couple things. Firstly, I know I haven't recorded a real episode in a few weeks. The last time that I posted an episode to the podcast feed was on November 11th. And then I didn't post another one throughout all of November because that one on November 11th was so long. It was like an hour and 40 minutes long that I didn't have any space to post podcast episodes anymore for the rest of the month. But there were two live episodes, which I'm going to include after this little message. So I'll post those. And then hopefully I can resume regular recording here pretty soon. The reason this is so fucking late, I tried to do this a week ago. But my microphone wasn't picking up any sound and I was having a hard time figuring it out. And really all it took was a simple Google search to find out that I just needed to uninstall the hardware and then reinstall it and everything would be fine. So here you go. Here's two episodes of Adulting with Donnie that I recorded in November. And then they just didn't make it to the feed until now. So, hope everyone had a great Thanksgiving, and I will talk to you in a real, regular, back-to-normal episode soon. Bye. What is up? It's going to be a quick episode, all right? It's Sunday night, it's 8:30, my girl, she's in the shower right now, I get like 20 spare minutes, maybe, at best. And, I gotta knock one of these out. What's up, everyone? It's Adulting with Donnie. I don't even know what the fuck to talk about other than maybe how my week and weekend was. It took me 3 days to come down off the high of flying by myself. I don't care if I spent 20 minutes talking about it on my last episode. I'm doing it again. I'm not going to spend 20 minutes talking about it. I'm just telling you, it took me 3 days to come down off that high. It was pretty awesome. And then I actually went to my school the other day because I deliver mail to the school. I'm sure I've mentioned that before. I went there the other day and some of the guys listened to this show for some reason. And they were cracking up. They were fucking dying laughing over the whole prostate exam / hernia exam that I went through. I guess it's not a normal thing. I guess that's not exactly a thing that most doctors do when they do a medical exam for your piloting license. So that was fun to learn. But yeah, it took me a couple days to come down off that high. And now I can't wait. I can't wait to fly again by myself. I can't wait to I don't know. It's just fun. I told Ro the other day, I have a 5-year plan. I have a 5-year plan going for flying, right? So obviously, the next step is really to get my license. There's a few steps between here and there. Like I have to do solo cross country, which is, I have to be able to fly a plane from my home airport, which is in Portsmouth. I have to be able to fly a plane to a couple different airports and be able to get back. There's a few tests that I have to take, written tests that I have to be able to take and pass. So. And there's plenty of study guides out there to help me do that, so I'm not worried about it. For once in my life, I have tests coming that I'm not actually worried about. So, that's my first hurdle is I want to get my pilot license, and then I think I want to get my certified flight instructor. I don't really know why right now I want it, but it's something that I want because it's like, I don't know. It's just, I think it's good to set some sort of future goal, for me anyways, for mental health reasons, for me to set some sort of future goal. And me and Ro, we make plans all the time, which are a lot of fun. We have all sorts. I mean, we could have the next 2 months of our life off together and probably not even get through our movie list, much less all the other shit that we have on our list of things that we want to do together. We have bars that we want to go to and places we want to visit. Both, I mean, we have like local places that we want to visit, and then we have like faraway places. Like we both want to go to Egypt or Ireland or, Australia. I think Australia's on the list. I can't be sure about that. But like Italy, I know Italy is on the list. Like, there's just so many places that we want to go together. So it's good to have some sort of future goal in mind. I didn't really mention it. Like, I didn't talk about it anyways because I really wanted to tell Ro about it first. I wanted her to first hear it firsthand. But And now, a week and a half later, it might be a little hard for me to remember the details, but I'm going to try. The last time I did an episode was on Veterans Day, just over a week and a half ago. And that night, I went to Applebee's, right? Because Veterans Day, Applebee's on Veterans Day, they give free meals, right? So, so I went to Applebee's to get my free steak, and I sit at the bar, and first of all, I order steak. I order it medium rare. I usually order it rare. I should have ordered it rare. I ordered it medium rare, and this thing came out well done for sure. But I was like, whatever, it's free. I guess the price matches. You know, you get what you pay for, and this was literally free. So I get my fucking steak. But the entertainment. Oh, I was sitting at the bar by myself because Ro went shopping, like Christmas shopping with her friend. And so I was at Applebee's by myself. So I'm sitting at the bar and I ended up sending her a picture. Just down the bar from me is this group of people. There's like two guys sitting there and then there's this woman who's not part of their party. But she's one of these fucking women. And I have one of these in my life. Not so much anymore. But just has to be heard by everyone in the goddamn bar. I know that you know what I'm talking about. You've encountered these people who they need their dumb conversation to be heard by everyone else. They want everyone else to hear them. They think they're like putting it off like, oh, I don't really want everyone to hear this. But they really want everyone to hear. They want that attention. They want someone to fucking, you know, talk to them. So anyways, this woman like... She's sitting next to this one guy that's a super dork. I mean, this guy is just a nerd. He's got the tie. He's got the glasses. You get the image in your head right now of what a massive dork looks like. That's this guy. That's what he looked like. And then next to him is two other guys who are like kind of, I would describe them as like burly men. You know, they're wearing the sweatshirts and they get the fucking dirty Carhartts on. And, you know, they probably do some sort of welding or something for a living. I don't know, something like that. And they're just coming home from work. You know, they stopped at Applebee's before they go home and, you know, I don't know, drink themselves to bed or something. I don't even know how to put it. But anyways, this woman, she's sitting there and the bartender comes up and she goes, "You're all set." And she goes, "What do you mean I'm all set?" And she's like, "You're all set. Your bill's all set. You're paid for." And she looks over at these two burly men. I'm convinced that the nerd paid for her bill, hoping that maybe she'd turn to him and be like, and she's not even like a great looking woman. I'd have to go back through my phone to find the picture of her, which I have no interest in doing. But from what I remember, she was probably like early, mid 50s and looked the part. And, you know, she's probably two or three times divorced. And so this guy, this nerdy guy sitting next to her probably paid her bill for her. And then these other two guys totally took the credit for it. They didn't technically take the credit for it. She just turned to them and she was like, "Did you guys pay for my bill?" And then they're just kind of like, "I don't know. Maybe not. No, I don't know. Maybe." And they didn't deny it, but they also didn't, you know, say otherwise. You know, they didn't correct her. They didn't deny it. They didn't say yes. They didn't say no. So then she says, you know, I'm kind of like barely listening to them talk at first because I don't care. But then she says, "So I have to ask, have you guys seen the movie Dune?" And I have seen the movie Dune. I was less than impressed. I don't think that Jason Momoa got nearly enough screen time, nor did Josh Brolin, nor did David Bautista. But hey, I never saw the original, so I don't really know their parts. But anyways, she says, "Did you guys see the movie Dune?" And then she says, "Because my son is one of the producers." And this just sets off all sorts of alarms in my head. And I went straight to Google and I spent the next 15 minutes of my life going through the producers of the movie Dune to find out where these people are from. Now, most of them don't have a Wikipedia. There's like four producers on the movie Dune. And I think that three of them didn't have a Wikipedia, or at least a very good Wikipedia. So I went through and like checked out all these people, where they're, you know, where they're from, where they come from, where did they, you know, how did they get to where they're at and whatever. None of them are from New England. Now, that doesn't mean that she's also, you know, that doesn't really mean that she's from New England, so her kids are, but still, I'm listening to her talk and I'm like, this lady is full of shit. And then all, like, they were fucking, all of it was just fucking weird. A lot of it I'm pulling from fragmented memories now because I'm trying to remember it, but like, she asked these guys what they did for work, and they're like, well, we work at the shipyard. There's a Navy shipyard, like, 20 feet away from me right now. They're like, we work at the shipyard. And she's like, oh, what do you do? And then they're like, we can't tell you. And it was all just so it was like a weird version of Stolen Valor. Like, these guys were ordering off of the Veterans Eat for Free menu, and then they told her they're not veterans. So that's some bullshit for starters. Then they do this whole like, oh, we can't tell you what we do at the shipyard. What do you mean you can't fucking tell people what you do at the shipyard? You work on submarines. End of story. And then the nerd in the middle was kind of like, I have a son and he was in Afghanistan, and I asked him once what he did in Afghanistan, and he was like, I could tell you, but I have to kill you. And I was like, nobody says that. That literally never has happened in history. No one has ever replied to a sentence that way. In honesty. Oh, hi. Oh.
You can't see me, right?
I don't know. I'm looking at my, I don't think I can. No, it's all green screen. I just got handed a beer by my barmaid. No, yeah, I can't see you. Yeah, she's dressed very nice. She's dressed in a way that I very
nice shower cap.
Very much appreciate.
I love you.
I love you more. Thank you for the beer.
Wait, that I can lean in and kiss you.
Yes, you can. Well, yeah, you can. Mm-hmm. I love you.
I love you.
Yeah, it was all just fucking weird. I don't know why my microphone just jumped up like that in volume, but it did. So sorry. Let me just check the timestamp on that so I can lower it down a little bit, maybe. So, anyways, that was fucking weird. It was entertaining though, because it really gave me like fuel for later when I came home. Like, oh, I can't wait for Ro to get home so that I can tell her this story. And then she got home that night. I told her all about flying, even though I had seen her earlier in the day. I got to tell her like kind of more in-depth stuff of the flying that day. So yeah, that was my high. But the fucking, I was in such a good mood on Thursday night after flying like that. And then even though I was still riding that high for a few days, Friday morning, just everything went out the fucking window. Everything turned to shit real fast because I went back to work and they understaffed all of us, and I ended up working Friday night until like 8:30 at night, and then Saturday wasn't much better. Saturday was like 7:30 or 8, and to work that late on a Saturday is just, it's an uncommon at the post office. Usually by 5 o'clock at the post office, at my office anyways, by 5 o'clock everyone is gone. So there was that. So that sucked. But this past week wasn't bad. Worked my day off and talked to my postmaster real quick about some safety stuff, because I don't know if I ever mentioned it on this show. I don't think I did, but I am the safety coordinator for my post office, for the city carriers of my post office. So I get to be the safety coordinator, which means that I need to pick out stuff that I think that we could fix in our office, things that I think that would make the city carriers safer, that I think need addressing. Like over the summer, for the whole reason that I ended up in this position was because I noticed that the post office wasn't giving us water you know, and of course I can go to any gas station and buy my own water, but the post office is the one putting me out in this condition. So I kind of thought, yeah, the post office should at least offer us at least a bottle of water here and there. I'm like, what the fuck? And then I found out that the post office was only giving us water on days when it was over 85 degrees. Well, I went to my postmaster at the time. It was a different person than it is now. I went to that postmaster and I was like, the post office realizes that water is an essential part of life, right? Like, it doesn't just apply on hot days. Like, I need it every, like, we need water. People in general just need water. And that's when, you know, she took my advice on that, listened to me, and then she came up to me later and she was like, hey, you know, what you said made a lot of sense. I don't know if you're interested, but we need a city carrier safety coordinator. Would you be interested in the position? Which it doesn't, it's not like it pays anything. It doesn't pay me more or anything. It's really just, you know, once a month or once a quarter. So once every 3 months, we're supposed to have a meeting on safety, on things that, so there's like a, there's a city carrier safety coordinator. There's a clerk's safety coordinator. There's a maintenance team safety coordinator. So there's all these different positions, and so I'm one of them. So I was like, yeah, sure. So because here's the thing, I'm super passionate or upset, I don't know what the word you want to use is, passionate or upset about this one thing at the post office. And that one thing is that there are just shootings constantly when it comes to postal workers like myself getting held up, being attacked, getting stabbed or shot. I can Google postal worker shot right now and probably get page after page after page on Google. And it's not the fucking Go Postal thing, because I hate the Go Postal thing. I really don't like it. I don't like it because of the stigma that comes with it. It's based on mass shootings at post offices. So I really don't like it. I'm not a fan of that at all. But there's postal shooting, because, you know, you say Go Postal and that is about fucking people. That is about disgruntled employees who walked into their post office and shot the place up. This, what I'm talking about, is people getting held up. Like a few years ago in Dorchester, Massachusetts, a postal carrier like myself was leaning into the back of his mail truck to get packages, and someone came up and shot him. So that he could steal, because I'm riding around with fucking thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of valuables in the back of my mail truck. So that was always kind of a something that bothered me, was just, you know, I've been there for almost 9 years, and in 9 years, there has been exactly one time that one postal inspector came to talk to us about mass shootings. And I think it was shortly after a mass shooting. And he was talking about someone coming into our building, which is a secured building. Like, there's a door code to get in and everything. So, you know, he talked to us about that and, like, the run, hide, fight stuff and, like, you know, get to a safe area. And if you can't get away, then make sure you're fighting for your life, that type of shit. That's what he's talking to us about. No one has ever talked to us in 9 years. No one has ever talked to us about how to deal with confrontation, how to de-escalate things, how to do anything like that. So I finally, you know, I haven't had a safety meeting yet since I've been a safety coordinator, and we've scheduled a bunch and then not been able to do them. And then finally the other day I went to my postmaster and I was like, hey, do you have a minute? I want to talk to you. And sat down with him and told him kind of my concerns and my feelings about this. And also told him, like, Portsmouth Police offers this kind of training, like offers these trainings, and it can be done in 10 minutes or 15 minute blocks. You know, it doesn't have to be a 2 hour thing that you're going to have to worry about paying overtime for. We can do this in a couple minute blocks in the morning. You know, rather than, you know, it'd be better than the postal inspector coming back here and just saying a bunch of shit, like, ugh. And so he took down some notes, and he did tell me anyways that he emailed the postal inspector that day about talking to us about some of the things that we can do. So we'll see where that goes. I figure I'll give him 3 or 4 weeks, and then I'll bring it up to him again and be like, hey, what happened with that? Where do we go? So, all right. So I'm almost 20 minutes in here, and I'm going to talk about some advertising. 4HM Clothing, you know what it is. That's my buddy Justin. You can get some of his clothes and hats and stuff that he makes. Christmas is coming. Make sure you get over there. Buy something. Support this show. Support the people that support me. It's 4HMClothing.com. Use offer code ADULTING at checkout. You get 10% off any order over $50. MileHighAngel.com, same deal. I mean, it's Christmas season, so we're talking fucking Christmas shit here today. MileHighAngel.com, you can go there. There's all sorts of, there's a fucking, I don't have her Tumblr tonight because I'm using my USPS Tumblr tonight. But, you know, there's tumblers, there's keychains, there's all sorts of little goodies that you can get. Use offer code ADULTING, you get 10% off your order. Manscaped.com. My girl is singing in the bathroom, which I always love. I love it when she's singing. I'll be sitting on the couch downstairs and I'll pause Modern Family so I can listen to her singing. Manscaped.com. They get the lawnmower 2.0. They get the plow. That's a razor. So what you do is you use the lawnmower 2.0, which is an electric shaver. And you use that to kind of groom up and make sure that things are looking good. And then you get the plow, and then you know, really get things down to the nothing there. That's what I like to do. I like to do a little trimming, all right? It's like taking care of your lawn, all right? You want to make sure that you have a nice lawn. Your girlfriend, you know, you start dating a new girl, you get the girlfriend coming over, you want to make sure that you get the lawn mowed. All right, there's a little innuendo in there. I'm not sure, you know, take from it what you will. And lastly, AdamEve.com. You go to AdamEve.com. Oh, yeah, Manscaped.com. Use offer code ADULT and get 20% off your order plus free worldwide shipping. AdamEve.com. Use offer code ADULT and get 50% off any one item plus a bunch of other shit. You get free shipping. You get six free DVDs. You get a gift for him, a gift for her, a gift for you both. There's all sorts of cool little, you know, like I said, Christmas is coming. You want to get to fucking Adam and Eve. What do they got on there? You know, and the guy, because I know that it's mostly guys listening to the show anyways. What you do is you go to AdamEve.com and you just copy a link and you send it to your girlfriend. Say, hey, this looks like a cool Christmas gift. Because you know what? Sometimes a Christmas gift for her is really a Christmas gift for you anyways. So what you do is you go there and you see something you like, let's see here, sex toys. Let's see here. There's a section for, let's go to couples sex toys. What does the couples sex toys look like? Couples vibrator. What is this? All right. Oh, the Love Sense Lush. Does my offer code work on the Love Sense Lush? Let's find out together. This is $139.95 on AdamEve.com. Let's see if my offer code works, because sometimes it has like a price cap on it. So far, looking good. Wait, no, price can't be discounted. So no, unfortunately, you still get the free shipping, but the price of the item can't be discounted. But hey, whatever. Go there, use the offer code anyways. You go there, the Love Sense Lush Bluetooth Bullet Vibrator. You know, that's a cool gift for you and her. That's what I'm talking about. Is it a gift for you? Sometimes it's a gift. Sometimes a gift for her is actually a gift for you. So you tell her, hey, buy this thing. It's really something you're going to use, but I'm going to get a lot of enjoyment out of you using it. That's what you do. That's how you make this happen. That's, you know, and she'll fucking, I don't know, maybe she'll, you know, use it often and tell you about what she's doing with it. All right. I'm just spitballing here. Could be fun. All right. I think that's going to do it for me. I told you right off the top, it was going to be a short episode because I got things to do. You can find me, my socials, Adulting Donnie on Instagram, Adulting with Donnie podcast on Facebook. And adultingdonniepod@gmail.com if you want to shoot me an email, which no one ever does, which is fine. That's perfectly fine by me. All right, bye. Okay, so I told you that one was probably, I think I told you that one was probably going to be short. But that was the first of two episodes that I recorded in November that never made it to the feed. And this is the second episode of November that never made it to the feed. So, see ya. So I'll do this a little bit backwards versus usual. Usually, like, hit record in the podcast studio, and then I go live. And then tonight I decided to go live instead first, but it doesn't matter. It's like a half a second. Happy Sunday. I got something really cool here for you you video watchers. Hold on, let me get to that screen here. Check this out right here. Yeah, it's a huge deal. Okay, that right there, it's the cover of the Portsmouth Herald for Sunday, November 28th. All right, that's my girlfriend on the cover. That's my girlfriend on the front page above the fold, for an unsolved homicide, double homicide here in Portsmouth years ago, back in 1991, right? It's that old. This case is that old. Coming up on 31 years. This couple here, in the neighborhood that we live now, Roe actually lived here way back then when this happened. Unfortunately, I don't know a ton about the case, but I know a few of the highlights, which is basically that their place, it was an apartment, burned down, and they thought these two people died in the fire until they did the autopsy and found out that this was a double murder. These two people had been killed before the place was set ablaze. So I had heard about it before me and Rochelle started dating. Rochelle's been a detective since 2009. So I had heard about it a long time ago when I first started working here in Portsmouth. And like, especially when I got into like true crime podcasts, I think I Googled once like New Hampshire unsolved cases, or maybe I Googled like unsolved murders, Portsmouth, New Hampshire, or something like that. I'd looked into unsolved, like open unsolved cases here in the area. So I knew about that one before we started dating, and then we started dating, and she talked about it a little bit. But then in August of this year, they told her at Portsmouth PD that she was going to be assigned the case. So now she's assigned to it. She's got this huge binder of stuff to go through. I don't ask her a lot. Intentionally, I don't ask her a lot about it because I don't know. I think about... I think of some of the true crime podcasts that I've listened to and how they talk about like the police not wanting to give every detail for specific reasons. Like they don't want, you know, their potential suspect to know what they know because they need that just, you know, as an example, if like someone is killed and left in a specific park, right? And we'll just, you know, say someplace in New York City, right? Where there's murders fucking every 20 minutes. So like Central Park, and a body is found in Central Park. The police might not release that specific park because they don't want everyone to know, because when they interview their suspect, they might be like, you know, well, how do you know that it was this park that this body was left at? Something stupid like that, right? And I'm not doing a good job of explaining it, but I get it. So I don't want to know a lot. I don't want her to, you know, tell me a lot about whatever it is she knows. She doesn't talk to me about potential suspects or people who've been cleared. She doesn't tell me any of that stuff, which is perfectly fine. I'm excited for her to close it. No pressure. I'm excited for her to, you know, be able to work it, at the very least, be able to work the whole thing and get maybe even some information that she didn't have before, at the very least, to be able to move it along. And like this news article, like she mentions in the news article, like we've never given up on it. It's not something that Portsmouth Police or anyone has ever given up on. It's unfortunate because it does seem like, I don't know enough about it to say it's something that should be solved. Like one of my it sounds weird to say like favorite unsolved cases, but something that I follow very closely is the Delphi murders. So if you don't know anything about it, the Delphi murders are these two girls, like 13 years old, 13, 14 years old. They have a scheduled day off from school. These are like scheduled day off for snow days over the winter. So they had a scheduled day off and they want to go walk down this trail in Delphi, Indiana. And this one girl, I mean, when this fucking case gets solved, which it's absurd that it's coming up on like 4 or 5 years now that this case is unsolved. It's absurd that it hasn't been solved yet because someone for sure knows something. But this girl sees this weird ass guy on the trail that they're walking, and she opens up her, I think she opened her Snapchat, and she took a, I think she took a picture of this guy. And then she gets her video going, and she has video and audio of this guy who somehow gets control of them. There's a great podcast out there called Down the Hill. I told Ro to listen to it about a little more than a year ago. She was driving to Virginia or Maryland, one of the two. She was driving down there, and I was like, okay, great. You know, this is an 8-episode podcast. It's like, you know, it's about an hour each per episode. You got to listen to this. Give it a listen. And so it's called Down the Hill. And this weird-ass motherfucker somehow gets control of these girls, and she records him saying, they've only released a couple of clips of the recording, and it sounds like he says, he either says, guys, down the hill, or he says, girls, down the hill, one of the two. And so they're missing, they're only missing for like 15, 20 minutes before, because they were supposed to, walk from one end of the trail to the other end of the trail. So one of their family members is waiting at the other end of the trail for them to come out. And they don't. And when they don't come out, she starts walking down the trail to try and find them, and she can't. So she starts, you know, she raises the alarm, starts making phone calls. Hey, you know, I can't find the girls. They were supposed to come out at 3 o'clock. They didn't show up. And then there's an entire search overnight for these two girls. They don't find them overnight. And then the next day they find the two of them. They're dead. And, but on one of them, on their phone, they have this recording. They have the picture of the guy that she posted to Snapchat. I think that's how it went down. She posted this picture of the guy to Snapchat. And then they have the video and audio that they've released. I don't think they've released any of the video, but they have released the audio. And they've released the picture that she took of the guy. And it's crazy that this case remains unsolved, because there's almost no reason that it should be unsolved. You have your suspect. Justin chiming in. Justin from 4HM Clothing. Hope she gets the person. Tammy, if anyone can, it will be her. Justin, town that fears sundown was never solved. And did you see the Texas man shooting? I don't know anything about either one of those, Justin. But another great one. Actually, one of the really great ones, and I don't mind saying it's a favorite. Now I'd have to remember, they made an entire documentary about this. Let's see here. The town that got away with murder is, this guy, Ken McElroy in somewhere, Skidmore. And that's the name of the documentary actually is Skidmore. I think that's the name of the documentary. Skidmore, Missouri. This guy was a fucking bully in like the 70s and 80s. Early 80s, because he was killed in 1981. This guy is killed in front of like 60 people. Like 60 people were right there when he died, and the police showed up and they're like, what happened? And the entire town, because it was a small ass town, the entire town is like, yeah, I don't know. Didn't see anything. I don't know. This guy was a fucking bully as fuck. He would take people's money. He would rape people's daughters, and then he would marry the daughter so that she couldn't testify against him. It was insane. And finally one day, it sounds like at least two people had enough. They were done with this motherfucker, and they put him down, and the entire town was like, yeah, I don't know what happened. I'm sorry, wish I could tell you something, but I can't. The FBI has been there to investigate. They got nothing. There have been people like reporters and stuff who've moved to town to try and get some information, And those reporters ended up getting turned. Those reporters were like, yeah, I didn't learn anything. Sorry. And also, I don't want to work for you anymore. And also, this is where I live now. But this one here, the one that Roe is now investigating, it's JJ and Stella. And they, you know, to go on 30 years, to go over 30 years of not being solved. And it's just, it's too bad for many, many reasons. It doesn't seem like it should have gone on this long. Knowing the little that I do about it, and I'm being 100% honest, Roe has not told me much about anything. She hasn't told me anything more than what is open to the public. Anything about, like, and nothing that you couldn't find online if you went there. But it just sounds like someone knows something and someone's protecting someone. So that's where I was going with the whole Delphi thing. Like, the one in Delphi, it seems like you have to, like, somebody knows who this person is. I'm surprised that the police don't know who this person is. Unless this person has never done anything at all. Which is totally possible. Maybe this person has never done a thing in their life, never done a bad thing in their life, and then for whatever stupid-ass reason, they just one day decide to commit a double fucking murder. And people, you know, one or two people, you know, a whole bunch of people, it doesn't matter, are protecting this person. Like, well, yeah, you know, he made one mistake. Well, okay, fine. You know, that this person made one mistake, but there's still two people dead. Like, you know, in the case of Delphi, there's still two little girls who died, and this person needs to answer for that. And I don't care what the court wants to say. You know, we just saw that in the Ahmaud Arbery case. Like, great, you know, bring your person to court, but it's going to be the judge and the jury at the end of the day that are going to make a decision, and someone needs to answer for the crime. The Ahmaud Arbery case, like, that was fucking... I'm glad that went the way that it did. And I think that most people knew right off the bat, like, this is the way that's going to go. Like, there were some things that Roe told me the other night that I didn't know. Like, I guess one of the guys that killed Ahmaud Arbery was a former police officer. And then also they have a fucking Confederate flag on the front of their truck. And I don't give a fuck who you are. Like, the Confederate flag, the only thing that it does not, there's no, you can't change my mind on this whole heritage not hate thing. Like, like, if you were supporting that flag, it literally supported one thing: we want slaves. That's all the Confederate flag did. That's, there is no fucking, well, it was about being American and it was about having a farm and it was about having freedom. Fuck you and your freedom and your fucking farmland and all that other bullshit, because you know what, we had that up here in the Union. We had that up here on this end of the country. We had our freedom and our guns, and we had, you know, farmland, and we had all this shit. The only thing that we didn't have that you wanted was slaves. It's just, it's the most ridiculous thing in the world to me to be like, well, I want the Confederate flag because it means heritage, not fuck you in your face, okay? Those people are the dumbest fucking people. And unfortunately, that might even be some of my listeners, and I don't care. I don't mind losing a couple listeners who are like, it's heritage, not hate. Yes. No, it was literally all about hate. You supported exactly one thing. That was literally all that flag stood for. Because we had all the other things. We wanted our free labor. That's what we wanted. We wanted our free labor that we could beat and rape and all this other bullshit. Like, ugh, you're gross. Okay. You're gross. Anyways, my girlfriend is working a cold, an unsolved case. I intentionally try to word it as open unsolved, because cold case has always kind of had this, stigma of being a case that was given up on, and just they stopped working it, and now it's coming back a few years later. I've listened to a ton of podcasts that are about cold cases that are unsolved cases that get solved. There was an entire show called Cold Case that's now a podcast. You can listen to it in its podcast form. That is kind of like that. Like, and that's how they portray it, is just, oh, this thing happened, and we get, it's portrayed in the show and on the podcast as like, we gave up on it and then we came back later. I think a lot of those cases, they don't actually give up on them. They step back for a minute and then they come back with fresh eyes, and that shit happens all the time. And that's actually really great, is when you come back with fresh eyes, not necessarily fresh eyes, but like, all right, let's take a minute, assign someone new to the case, and we'll see if that person maybe sees something that we didn't see the first time around. Maura Murray's coming up on 20 years. It's going to be close. It's going to be 18 years. I think it'll be 18 years in this February. And they just found bones on Loon Mountain in September that they thought, well, maybe. And it turned out to not be Maura Murray. I've done an entire episode about Maura Murray. I don't know what happened to her. I still think that she's out in the woods somewhere. I think that dead. She's out in the woods, not alive. If I had to take a guess, I think that that night she had been drinking in the car. So this is my Cliff Note version of what I think happened to Maura Murray. She got a phone call saying, hey, your license is suspended in New Hampshire, because she got a speeding ticket in New Hampshire. And then she didn't pay it, so her license was suspended in New Hampshire. I think that she was coming to New Hampshire to take care of that. I think that she was going to stay somewhere in that area, in that Haverhill, New Hampshire general vicinity. I don't know what the fuck is out there. There's Haverhill, and then, like, that's it. I think she was going to stay out there somewhere. And she, she's drinking on her way there, and she spun her car out and decided she didn't want to get in trouble for drinking and driving, which who knows if she would have. It sounded like she barely had that much. Like, it sounded like she didn't have enough to drink that would have put her over the limit. I don't know if that's true or not, obviously, and I don't think we'll ever know. But I think that she spun her car out, wrecked on that snowbank, couldn't drive the car away, and she decides to walk down the road, sees a police cruiser coming in her direction, jumps into the woods thinking, I'll jump in the woods, I'll get off the road so that the police can't find me, I'll get into the woods, and then she gets turned around somehow and she can't find her way out of there. I've looked at the Google images, the Google Earth of that area, and there's a huge amount of woodland out there. Like, within a mile of where she wrecks her car, and wrecks is probably not the right word to use, because she didn't really wreck her car. She just, she hit a snowbank and that's it. I don't even know why she couldn't drive away from there. It doesn't look like it was, totaled or anything like that, but she couldn't get, either way, she walks away, gets turned around in the woods and gets lost. And now she's out there somewhere, after almost 20 years of snowstorms and windstorms and hurricanes and all this other shit. So, but anyways, they found some bones up on Loon, and they determined that at first they thought they might be hers, but then they determined they were not hers. So, that was all in the last like 2 months, and then in the last 2 weeks, I think, is when they determined they were not her bones. Excuse me. So, anyways, those are my thoughts on unsolved cases so far. What's going on? It's Sunday night. I've had a great Sunday. We got up, we slept until fucking 11 o'clock this morning, which is great. I love sleeping in on Sundays with my mate. And then we got up, we went out, got a Christmas tree. Cause you're not supposed to get a Christmas tree before Thanksgiving. Okay. You're not supposed to do fucking anything Christmas before Thanksgiving. I couldn't believe it when it was hard enough to believe in November before Thanksgiving, when stores started selling Christmas stuff before Thanksgiving. Like, stores just push everything forward as fast as possible. Like, I can tell you right now, on January 1st, 2022, you will start seeing the Valentine's Day stuff come out. And on February 15th, you'll see the St. Patrick's Day stuff come out. And on March 18th, you'll probably start seeing the Memorial Day stuff come out. You know, all the flags and the red, white, and blue and all that stuff. I mean, working at Lowe's, I worked at Lowe's for like 6 months, and they have like 100 days. It wasn't called 100 days of summer, but it was called 100 days of something. And it was basically, I don't know, July 15th minus 100 days. So sometime in like early March is when they started pushing out like lawnmowers and grills and all the lawn care equipment and all, like, they just start like really pushing that stuff in their sales ads. And it just seems like everything just gets pushed forward just a little bit more. I mean, usually by mid-July, maybe even early July, is when you start seeing back to school sales. Like, dude, I just got out of school. I just got out. So, but anyways, we don't do that. We don't do Christmas any decoration at all pre-Thanksgiving. That said, I don't mind doing a little Christmas shopping before Thanksgiving. But Christmas decorations, they don't go up until Thanksgiving is done. So we went out and got our tree today. It's already inside the house. It's set up. It's ready to go. It's ready to be decorated. I think we're going to decorate it next Saturday. I think that's the plan right now. That might change. We'll see. But that's up and ready to be decorated. We had an awesome Thanksgiving, our second Thanksgiving together. It was actually, I don't remember if I mentioned it on one of the most recent episodes, but like 2 or 3 weeks ago, Ro goes out with her sister, goes out, you know, I think they actually went Christmas shopping of some sort, or maybe they just went to go see a movie, one of the two. Either way, they were together. And, so she goes out with her sister, and her sister says, hey, we're going to do, we're going to have dinner for Thanksgiving, and you and Donnie, you guys are welcome to come by for it. And then Ro says, well, what Donnie, this is her, she gets like half of a sentence up. She goes, well, what Donnie and I usually do is, and her sister goes, what do you mean usually do? You guys, this is your second Thanksgiving. So we both had a good laugh at that. But either way, it was our second Thanksgiving and it was fucking awesome. I decided this year, so this is what we do, right? For the most part, Ro kicks me out of the kitchen and I watch a trilogy. TV is within sight and audio distance of the kitchen, so she can see it and kind of follow along if she wants to. I watch a trilogy and I drink all day. I drink all day and that's basically it. I hang out in my sweatpants and that's my day. I last year was Indiana Jones. I watched the first three Indiana Jones movies. This year was Back to the Future. Did all three Back to the Future movies. Didn't finish. Didn't make it to the end. Mostly because I got a late start. I don't think I started the first movie until like 11:30 in the morning. And the turkey was done earlier than we expected. The turkey was done at like 4 PM. And we did, we ate at the table together, which was super nice to sit at the table together and just kind of talk and talk about our favorite Thanksgivings and talk about just life in general and our past and, things we want for the future. And just, it was just a great day. I smoked a cigar on the porch while I watched airplane videos and shot off a couple text messages to a couple friends saying happy Thanksgiving. She sent off happy Thanksgiving to a lot more friends. But it was a really fun day. I drank tequila all day and then, maybe not all day. I think I had like 2 glasses of tequila. Patron only. So it was fun. It was another great Thanksgiving. It was just another fucking knockout. Here's my question, right? Let's run down the little checklist, all right? Let's run down a little checklist here of me, all right? Has a podcast. Check. Can be mildly funny. Check. Goes on rants. Check. Has a black girlfriend. Check. half black, girlfriend. Flies airplanes, check. Let's see here. Bakes stuff, check. So I wonder, am I like Bill Burr 2.0? Maybe like a worser version of Bill Burr? Because I've hit a bunch of his boxes so far in that little checklist. I baked, yeah. So that's what I was getting at, was I baked a pie. This time around, so last year I baked a pumpkin pie for Thanksgiving. And then over the summer I baked a peach cobbler. And then the other night I made a blueberry pie with a lattice, I don't know, top for it. I thought it came out pretty good, for especially for my first time ever doing that. It came out pretty good, but I definitely want to bake more. Like I shouldn't say I've always wanted to bake more, but in the last year and a half, I've wanted to do more baking. There's a lot more cooking that I want to do. Like, we watch Top Chef all the time, and I really want to do a rack of lamb, and I really want to try cooking red snapper. I've never had either one, so I definitely want to try both of those. But so I baked this pie, came out pretty good. Certainly tasted good, but man, it is a lot. When you're like baking your own stuff, when you're baking pies and cobblers, like, yeah, I see now like how much fucking sugar goes into these things, because there is so much sugar in a blueberry pie. I think I had to put like 2 cups of sugar into this thing. There's a lot of sugar. And I think that the peach cobbler was 4 cups of sugar. It was a lot either way. It was a lot of sugar, but fucking worth it. It slows down my progress for my gym stuff, but totally worth it to take a couple days. I still went to the gym in fact, Thursday morning. So Thanksgiving morning, I got up at 7:00. And I wanted to go run. I had like an idea in my head of what I wanted to run. And then I got downtown Portsmouth and they were doing like a run down there. They were doing a run down there. So let's see here. I got Justin. Yes, I do have. I have 4 daughters, Justin. Scott said, looking forward to meeting you. Likewise. And Rochelle said, Donnie the Baker. That's what she put the little emoji in there. Donnie the Baker. It was so good. P.S. You can substitute Splenda for sugar. I don't know if that would taste as good. I don't like Splenda. Because I've ate both right out of the packet. And normal sugar is way better than Splenda out of the packet. So, hey, I'm willing to try it. All right. I feel like, the sky is the limit with Ro. So, but anyways, so, I don't know where I was. Either way, I know I was talking about cooking and baking. I want to try making red snapper. I want to try making a rack of lamb. I want to do more baking. I went to work the next day. Oh, that's what I was talking about. I was talking about working out. I'll get there. But I went to work the next day and me and 2 other carriers were talking about baking. And one of those carriers wants to do a cookie exchange where, and she's ambitious. I'll say that. She's ambitious to think that everyone is going to participate in this, because not everyone's going to participate in this. She wants everyone in the office, which is like 28 or 30 people, to bring in cookies on a specific date. If you bake, and she wants people to bake their own cookies. That shit is not going to happen. She also put that you can go to the store and buy cookies if you want, but I still don't think she's going to get a lot of participation in this. I will participate, just because I want to bake more. I already said that. So I'll make my own cookies and see what happens. I don't know what I'm going to make, chocolate chip or oatmeal raisin. It's going to be one of the two. Maybe, I don't know. Chocolate chip seems really easy, right? So I'll probably just try that. I think I might try that this week. If I have a day off this week, I might try that. So, but anyways, yeah, the gym. So on Thanksgiving morning, I had an idea in my head of what I wanted to run, and I didn't realize that that idea in my head intersected with the fact that the city of Portsmouth also wanted to do a run for everyone called the Turkey Trot, which they do all over the country on Thanksgiving Day, of these 5Ks, people, you know, doing a 5K. And so I was like, I drove downtown and didn't realize that fucking everyone was going to be there. There's probably, you know, a few hundred people there. So drove around downtown a few times looking for parking, couldn't find parking. And I was like, all right, fuck this. I'm coming home. Drove back home and I decided to run out of here. And I ran 4.5 miles and I was able to cover 2 miles in like 17 minutes, which is faster than 21-year-old me could do 2 miles. And I was also able to do a 5K, 3.1 miles. I covered 3.1 miles in like 25 minutes, which is faster than I could when I did a real 5K a few years ago. And then my 4.5 mile time was like, I don't remember what it was. I want to say it was like 38 minutes. So I was happy with my time. And then yeah, I got home, chilled out the rest of the day, and then Friday got up and I got up late as it was, went to the gym and I ran a mile, maybe a mile and a half. I was like, yeah, I'm just not feeling it today. I didn't want to do anything on Friday, but I did. So I got a mile and a half on Friday. And then on Saturday, I overslept entirely and just didn't go to the gym in the morning and texted Ro later. I was like, I think I'm going to get my gym bag and I'll go to the gym after work. I think I'm going to be out pretty early, so I'll go to the gym after work. So I did that yesterday, went to the gym. Ran for half an hour, found that a lot easier to run on a treadmill when you have a video just playing in front of you. I put on The Tomorrow War with Chris Pratt and watched the last half hour of that movie. And the first 10 or 15 minutes of running just flew by. I didn't even realize. I was like, oh shit, I'm fucking almost done. So did a half hour on there. So just dropping weight as much as I can. I've got this goal in my mind of 220. I want to get down to 220. I feel like I'll be very happy when I'm there. But now I'm in like go mode, because I had an idea of where I wanted to be mid-January 2022, and I'm down to the last 6 weeks of that. So I really got to fucking focus on waking up earlier, getting to the gym, putting in as much work as I can in over the course of like an hour and a half, 2 hours, so that when mid-January comes, I can look in the mirror and be like, okay, good. What sucks is that I'll look, like, if I, like, stand up and look down at myself, I'm like, wow, I haven't made any progress at all. But if I look in the mirror, I'm like, oh, shit, I'm not actually looking too bad. I guess I want to get to the point where I can, like, look down at myself and be like, all right, I'm there. So we'll see. I don't know. But I have made a lot of progress. Ro tells me all the time how much progress I've made, which is nice. Justin asked, have you seen the new Ghostbusters? No, I have not. I have seen some pretty good reviews, and I've seen the trailers, obviously. It doesn't look bad. Me and Ro are about to watch Spider-Man, because believe it or not, she's never fucking seen Tom Holland Spider-Man. Can you believe that shit? I can't either. Someone who is such a Marvel fan skipped those two movies. I don't know how. I guess I can justify it a little bit, because the first three with Tobey Maguire were total shit. They were bad movies. They could be considered great for their time. They were the early Marvel movies. They were the really early, among the first Marvel movies. So they were good, they were good for their time, but looking back on them now, it's like, okay, those sucked. They weren't that good at all. The Tom Holland ones are great. I'm really looking forward to the third one, which is coming out in just a few weeks. So I told Ro, like, we have to watch these first two. She's in the shower right now. I'm going to wrap this up in a few minutes so that I can make sure that's queued up and ready to go, because that's what we're going to watch tonight. So all that said, that's been about my fucking last week and a half or so. Went on an awesome little run with my friend Chris the last 2 weeks, or I guess it's been like 3 weeks now. We've gone on an awesome little run around the town of Newcastle, New Hampshire. It's the total distance is like 7 miles, but what we run is actually only about 6.5. You know, the time from the time that we walk away from our trucks to the time we get back is 7 miles, but there's a warm up walk and a cool down walk. So, so we run around the town of Newcastle, and we did it once a few weeks ago, like early November. Like, he texted me one day and he's like, "Hey, do you want to go run this fucking loop?" And I'm, yeah, okay, sure, I'll do that. And we ran it one day and I was kind of burnt out. Like, I mean, I was like, it's 6 miles, 6.5 miles, 7 miles. That's more than I have ever ran in my whole fucking life. I've never done that kind of distance before, which, I don't know, to me sounds stupid. Like, if you run at all, then like, is 7 miles even really that great? But, you know, I don't know. I look at it and I'm like, that doesn't seem like a lot to run 7 miles. But we did, so... and then he texted me a couple weeks ago and he was like, "You want to do it again?" I'm like, okay, I'm not going to say no. That's my worst part, is that I'm not going to be able to say no. If he texts me and says, "You want to go do it?" I'm not going to be able to say no. So he texts me and says, "You know, do you want to do it again?" Yep. Okay. So we did it again last Tuesday and it was 25 degrees out when we met up, and that's fucking cold. I wasn't wearing any gloves. I wasn't wearing a hat. Ro left me out some hand warmers. So I took the hand warmers. I was wearing a hoodie. I took the hand warmers and put them inside my little pouch on the hoodie. And I just, you know, when I wanted to warm up my hands, I'd pull them out and just hold on to them while I ran. But it was a cold fucking run. I was actually supposed to go fly a plane that day. And while we're running, the wind was so bad, I was like, there's no way I'm going to be able to fly today. And sure enough, I finished up the run. We finished up at like 7 o'clock, maybe 7:15. And I'm driving away from there knowing that I have to go home and get changed. And then I'm supposed to be at the airport at 7:30. And I'm driving home to get changed, and I'm checking the weather, and the weather is saying that the wind is blowing at like 11 or 12 knots. And, the max takeoff speed for that plane specifically is 11 knots. So I called the airport and, talked to the person at the front desk. I was like, I got to cancel the flight. There's no way I'm taking off in this. And they were fine with it. They totally understood. So I had to reschedule for this coming Tuesday. We'll see if I'm able to fly. I'm keeping an eye on the weather, and the wind isn't looking like it's going to be much better. So that sucks, but we'll see. You know, you never know. The wind is fucking weird. You know, it could be blowing 20 knots at 2:30 in the afternoon, and at 3 in the afternoon, it's you know, down to 2 or 3 knots. You know, so we'll see. We'll see. But that all of that said, I'm getting the fuck out of here. Okay. Don't forget, check out Justin at 4HM Clothing, AdamEve.com, MileHighAngel.com, and Manscaped.com. All of those, you can use offer code Adulting. You get varying discounts. Justin, 4HM Clothing, that's 10% off your entire order over $50. AdamEve.com is 50% off any one item. Manscaped.com is 20% off your entire order plus free shipping, and Mile High Angel is 10% off your entire order. So that's going to do it for me. Bye, everyone.